Hi everyone. Today we'll look into the second perspective of cognitive radio architecture, which is the cognition cycle. Cognitive radio architecture comprises a set of design rules by which the cognitive level of information services may be achieved by a specified set of components in a way that supports the cost-effective evolution of increasingly capable implementations over a time. The cognition subsystem of the architecture includes an inference hierarchy and the temporal organization and flow of inferences and control states, which is the cognition cycle. A cognition cycle by which a cognitive radio may interact with the environment is illustrated in this figure. Stimuli enter the cognitive radio as interrupts, dispatched to the cognition cycle for a response. Such a cognitive radio continuously observes the environment, then orients itself, creates plan, decides, and then acts. This cycle of cognitive radio implements the capabilities required for an ideal cognitive radio in a reactive sequence. The observe, orient, plan, decide, act, that is OOPDA loop, is a primary cycle. It is also called the OODA loop. Here, planning, learning and sensing the outside world are crucial phases necessary to be properly prepared for the OODA loop. In a single processor inference system, the cognitive radio's flow of control may also move in the cycle from observation to action. In a multiprocess system, temporal structures of sensing, pre-processing, reasoning, and acting may be parallel and complex. Special features synchronize the inferences of each phase. The entire process of cognition cycle occurs in the wake epoch because the primary reasoning activities during this large epoch of time are reactive to the environment. During the wake epoch, the receipt of a new stimulus on any of its sensors initiates a new primary cognition cycle. In addition, we observe that machine learning is structured into these phases. Since the assimilation of knowledge by machine learning can be computationally intensive, cognitive radio has sleep and prayer epochs that supports machine learning. Next, we refer to sleep epochs, which is preferably used for power down conditions. A sleep epoch takes a relatively long period of time, from minutes to hours, during which the radio will not be in use, but it will have sufficient electrical power for processing. During the sleep epoch, the radio can run machine learning algorithms without detracting from its ability to support its user needs. Then comes the dream epochs, which is used for performing computationally intensive pattern recognition and learning. Last, we see the prayer epochs, which is used for interacting with the higher authority such as network infrastructure. We also know that learning opportunities not resolved in the sleep epoch can be brought to the attention of the user, the host network, or to the designer during a prayer epoch. First comes the observing phase, which includes sensing and perceiving. Cognitive radio observes its environment by parsing incoming information streams. These can include monitoring and speech-to-text conversion of radio broadcasts. Any radio frequency LAN or other short-range wireless broadcasts that provide services awareness information may also be parsed. In the observation phase, a cognitive radio also reads location, temperature, and light level sensors among other parameters to infer the user's communications context. Thus, we see that cognitive radio senses and perceives the environment through observation phase. By accepting multiple stimuli in many dimensions simultaneously and by binding these stimuli altogether or more typically in subsets to prior experience so that it can subsequently detect time-sensitive stimuli and ultimately generate plans for action. Thus, cognitive radio continuously aggregates experience and compares prior aggregates to the current situation. That is, a cognitive radio aggregates experience by remembering everything. So, the computational architecture for remembering and rapidly correlating current experience against everything known previously is the core capability of cognitive radio architecture. A novelty detector identifies new stimuli using the new aspects of partially familiar stimuli to identify incremental learning primitives. Thus, observe phase comprises both the user sensory perception and the environment sensor subsystems, that is RF and physical subsystems. Next comes the orient phase, which determines the significance of observation by binding the observation to a previously known set of stimuli of a scene. Cognitive radio orients itself by determining the priority associated with the stimuli. Orient phase contains internal data structures that constitute the equivalent of short-term memory that people use to engage in a dialogue without necessarily remembering everything with the same degree of long-term memory. Typically, people need repetition to retain information over a long term. Natural environment supplies the information redundancy needed to instigate transfer from short-term memory to long-term memory. In cognitive radio architecture, transfer from short-term memory to long-term memory is mediated by the sleep cycle, in which the contents of short-term memory since the last sleep cycle are analyzed both internally and with respect to the existing long-term memory. Matching of current stimuli to stored experience is achieved either by stimulus recognition or binding. Orient phase is the first collection of activity in cognition component. First, we'll see about stimulus recognition. It occurs when there is an exact match between a current stimulus and a prior experience. The first perspective of cognitive radio prototype continuously recognizes exact matches and record the number of exact matches that occur along with the time measured in the number of cognition cycles between the last exact match. Sometimes the orient phase causes an action to be initiated immediately as a reactive stimulus response behavior. For example, a power failure condition might directly invoke an act of immediate path, while a non-recoverable loss of signal on a network might invoke reallocation of resources, that is, from parsing input to searching for alternative RF channels, which is accomplished through the path labeled urgent. However, an incoming network message would normally be dealt by generating a plan through the normal path. Next comes binding. It occurs when there is nearly exact match between a current stimulus and a prior experience, and also when a very general criteria for applying the prior experience to the current situation are met. Binding also determines the priority associated with the stimuli. Better binding yields higher priority for autonomous learning, whereas less effective binding yields lower priority for the incipient plans. Next comes the planning phase. Most stimuli are dealt deliberatively rather than reactively. An incoming network message would normally be dealt with by generating a plan in the plan phase through normal path. Such planning includes plan generation. In industrial strength cognitive radios, formal models of causality must be embedded into planning tools. The plan phase should also include reasoning about time. Typically, reactive responses are pre-programmed or defined by a network. That is, cognitive radio is told what to do, whereas other behaviors might be planned. A stimulus may be associated with a simple plan as a function of planning parameters with a simple planning system. Open source planning tools enable the embedding of planning subsystems into the cognitive radio architecture, enhancing the plan component. Such tools enable the synthesis of RF and information access behaviors in a goal-oriented way based on perceptions from visual, audio, text, and RF domains. The decide phase selects among the candidate plans. The radio might have the choice to alert the user to an incoming message, like a pager, or to defer the interruption until later, like a secretary who is screening calls during an important meeting. The acting phase initiates the selected processes using effector modules. Effectors may access the external world or the cognitive radio's internal states. Here, acting is categorized into external and internal oriented actions. First, in externally oriented actions, access to the external world consists primarily of composing messages to be spoken into the local environment or expressed in text form locally or to another cognitive radio or cognitive network using knowledge query and manipulation language, radio knowledge representation language, web ontology language, radio extensible markup language, or some other appropriate knowledge interchange standard. Next comes the internally oriented actions. Here, actions on the internal states include controlling machine controllable resources such as radio channels. The cognitive radio can also affect the contents of existing internal models, such as adding a model of stimulus experience response, that is SER model, to an existing internal model structure. The experience may be reactively integrated into RXML knowledge structures as well, provided the reactive response encodes them properly. Learning is a function of perception, observation, decision, and actions. Initial learning is mediated by the observe phase perception hierarchy. Learning also occurs through the introduction of new internal models in response to the existing models and case-based reasoning bindings. In general, there are many opportunities to integrate machine learning into aware adaptive cognitive radio. Finally, a learning mechanism occurs when a new type of SER model is created in response to an action to instantiate an internally generated SER model. For example, prior and current internal states may be compared with expectations to learn about the effectiveness of a communication mode instantiating a new mode-specific SER model. In self-monitoring, each of the prior phases consists of computational structures for which the execution time may be computed in advance. In addition, each phase must restrict its computations not to consume more resources than the pre-computed upper bound. Therefore, the architecture has some prohibitions and some dataset requirements needed to obtain an acceptable degree of stability. Since first-order predicate calculus, that is FOPC, used in some reasoning systems is not desirable, in general, one cannot compute in advance how much time an FOPC expression will take to run to completion. Any unnatural act can be facilitated by next-generation compilers and computer-aided software engineering, that is CASE tools. Finally, the cognition cycle itself cannot contain internal loops. Each iteration of the cycle must take a defined amount of time, just like each frame of the 3G AIR interface takes 10 milliseconds. By retrospection, we know that cognitive radio has sleep and prayer epochs that supports machine learning. We have very clearly seen about these epochs in earlier slides. During sleep epoch, the radio can run machine learning algorithms. These algorithms may integrate experience by aggregating statistical parameters. The sleep epoch may rerun stimulus response sequences with new learning parameters in a way that people dream. The sleep cycle could be less anthropomorphic. However, employing a genetic algorithm to explore a rugged fitness landscape potentially improves the decision parameters from the recent experience. Next, by reaching out, we observe that learning opportunities not resolved in the sleep epoch can be brought to the attention of the user, host network, or a designer during the prayer epochs. We refer to elevating complex problems to an infrastructure support through a prayer epoch. Thank you for watching this video. If you find this video to be useful, kindly subscribe it and share it with your friends. Don't forget to click that like button because it will motivate me to post more videos. If you want me to concentrate on any specific topic, kindly let me know in the comment section. Thank you once again.